pleasure to be here. It is, in fact, an honor to be here. I am so happy. Thank you, President Hughes, for inviting me. And thank you to Michelle O'Brien for facilitating my journey here. I want to talk to you about something that I think, as already Professor Hughes has told you, I think is so critically important to all of us. It's something we don't think about very often, but we should, and we don't. So, I want to talk to you about what I think is the most important motivation lying inside human beings. We sociologists have an interesting view, I think, on what human beings are. Our first principle is that very little of human nature is innate. You have to be taught how to be a human being. So becoming human is basically a social process. The teachers in your lives, we call socializing agents. So they include your family, your teachers, your friends, your lover, your employer, all of them throughout your life course are teaching you how to be a human being. They may not have that title to their job, but that's part of what they're doing. And it happens throughout the life course. We like to think that once we're through adolescence, we're now an adult and fully formed, but that's not true. And in learning how to be a human being, we build up an understanding of who we are, which we call the self-concept. The self-concept is the totality of all our thoughts and feelings about ourselves as an object. It's everything we know about ourselves, and it's everything we feel about ourselves. And without that, we have nothing. So it's critically important that our socializing agents, the people in our lives who are in charge of us, who are employing us, who are friends with us, help us learn who we are. And one of the things we learn, one element of that self-concept, is what I want to talk about today. And that is the extent to which we matter in the world around us. And I'd like to be able to proceed, but I don't seem to have the clicker.
That would be my fault. Sorry.
There we go. Thank you very much.
And why is it working? We behavioral and social scientists have an interesting dilemma, a challenge, when we do our research. Because we're basically studying us, all of us, which means it's very difficult to get that scientific objectivity that allows us to learn carefully who we are and what we do. So, in order to facilitate that, we become very picky about the concepts we use. Because the concepts we use could have a wide variety of connotations. It could mean different things to different people, sometimes subtly different, sometimes radically different. So it's important that we all understand what these concepts mean in exactly the same way. So we come up with very carefully thought out scientific denotations. And here is the definition, the scientific denotation of the concept of matter. It's the perception that, to some degree, and in any of a variety of ways, we are a significant part of the world around us. As President Hughes says, we like to know we make a difference in this world. Let's parse this definition. We'll start with the idea of perception. It is our understanding, not something necessarily objective. Do we see that we matter? Do we come to believe that we matter? If we don't see it, then for all intents and purposes, it's not there. So you can think, for example, of the father who says to his young boy, I have given you every toy you ever wanted. Doesn't that prove that you matter to me? And the boy, if he had the wisdom and perhaps the temerity, might respond to his father and say, well, yes, those toys were really nice. I really appreciated them. But you know what really would have been good? What really would have been good if once in a while you took me out in the backyard and we had a catch. Or if you went to my parent-teacher's meeting, that would have been really good. Children are not stupid. They can tell when they make a difference, and more importantly, when they don't. So perception is the key here. The second part of the definition, to some degree, and in any of a variety of ways. Well, let's start with some degree. The notion of mattering is considered a dimension of the self-concept. It is a continuum, a range of possibilities. And where you fall on that continuum depends upon the kind of socialization you receive, starting in infancy and continuing throughout the life course. Different people having different experiences in their growth and development will fall on different places on this continuum of mattering. So that we can see a wide variation in the extent to which people believe they make a difference in the world around them, thanks to the socializing experiences that they've received throughout the life course from all of those sources I've talked about. In any of a variety of ways, I'm going to tell you in a few minutes that there are three different but related facets to matter. Three different ways that you can tell whether or not you make a difference in the world around you. And each of them is critically important, but distinguishable. And a significant part of the world around us. We need to know that we make a difference in this world. Whether it be to another individual, to a social institution like the family, or indeed to an educational institution like CCRI. Whether you're faculty, staff, maintenance, or students, this place will succeed best when all realize that in their own way, all of us matter. When you fail to matter, as we're going to see, some very bad things can happen. And I guess I should give you a kind of trigger warning here in these days. I'm going to be talking about some stuff that's quite disturbing, because I'm going to show you what happens when people don't matter, or what can happen. So I said there were three different ways that you could matter. And the first one
Yes.
A very simple one, a very basic one, but a very profound part of mattering. And I call that part of mattering awareness. It's very simple, really. It's whether or not you can capture other people's attention. When you walk into a room, do other people notice that you've arrived? When you say something, do other people listen to you? Or do you have the feeling that they didn't hear what you had to say? And here's something I'm very bad at, but do other people connect your name to your face? Have you ever been in a situation where you've met someone new and you run into them several times, maybe it's the third or fourth time that you encounter them and they go, oh, hi, I confess, you'd think as a professor, I would be really good at putting names to faces. I am terrible. And I know the effect it has on my students. I'm so bad that I actually make up name cards for my seminar students. And I force them to bring them every week so that I can figure out who they are, because it makes a difference. If you can't remember somebody's name, what does that tell them about what you think of them? Well, it may be entirely innocent, as I like to believe I am, but I know it sends a message. You are not a part of my life in any significant way. A second facet goes into a relationship issue. The last two have to do with your relating to other people. And importance is the question of whether or not others invest in your welfare. Do they care about what happens to you? So, for example, when you have done something wonderful, do you have anybody to tell? Something good happens to you, it's always better when you can share it with somebody who cares. Now I think of the students who get accepted. They get their letter or they go on the web to find out, yes, you have been admitted. Do you have anybody to tell? If you don't, it's kind of sad. Because we like to share. We like to know that others are interested. Or when you're having a bad time, do you have a shoulder to cry on? Do you have somebody who will listen to your woes? And sincerely listen, not just because they're supposed to, but because they want to hear what's happening. The last one, also a relationship issue, but it goes in the other direction. And this is the notion of reliance. Reliance is when others look to you when they're in need. It's kind of nice when somebody asks your opinion. Oh, yeah, sure, I'll tell you what I think. That's really good. I like that. It's kind of nice when somebody comes to share with you what's happened to them. For both importance and reliance, the fundamental issue is, out of all the people that they could spend their energy on, they've chosen you. That's a good thing. Helps us know that we are interconnected. And that's what mattering is all about. Now, I will admit that a little bit of reliance can go a long way. It's nice if somebody wants your advice, but not if it's the fifth time today and it's 3 a.m. and they're calling you. Still and all, at least they thought you could help.
So for example, the parent who works two jobs so that his or her child can come to CCRI may hate the jobs, but the one thing they know is that because of it, their kid can advance. But isn't that what all parents want for their children? To do better, to get farther. So they know that their kids need them. As I said, it's all in the perception. That's the critical part. If you don't get that, you don't get anything about mattering. It's what you see in the world around you. It's the feedback you get from the people around you. We social psychologists say that we learn how to be a human being through several processes. And one of the most important is what we call reflected appraisals. The work of a psychiatrist named Harry Stack Sullivan back in the late 40s. And what Dr. Sullivan said was that we learn who we are by the way people react to us, by the way they treat us. And we take that in. And the interesting thing about that, especially during our early years, is that we take it in unquestioningly. Children are too far early in their cognitive development to be able to critique the reflected appraisals that they get from their parents or their teachers. It helps when you get a little older and you reach about the age of 12 and you can now start thinking in the abstract, dealing with concepts that you can't see. Then maybe you can think about what you're told. But before that, you take it in because your parents, your teachers, are omniscient, at least from where you sit. So you don't question. You know, there was a public service ad. It was on many years ago, but it stayed with me because it was all about mattering. And it showed a very tight shot of a woman's mouth. And she speaks and she says, "Can't you do anything right? What's the matter with you? Sometimes I wish you had never been born." Then it fades to black. And then you hear another voice, a different voice, saying, "Words hit like a fist. Be careful what you say to your children." That's all about mattering. Let me give you a popular example. Any of you seen the movie or the play Chicago? Anybody over there seen that? Well, you may remember, it's about Roxy, who wants to get very famous in the Roaring Twenties, and she does, but not in the way she intended, because she kills somebody. And she ends up being defended by this lawyer who sees her as a fast track to fame. Meanwhile, she has a husband whom she ignores readily, who seems to be an afterthought in her life, and he has a solo. Anybody know what the solo is? Mr. Cellophane. And what does he say? Well, I'm not going to sing it. But he says, "Mr. Cellophane should have been my name, because you can look right through me, walk right by me, and never know I'm there." That's not mattering on a grand scale. And it's what he saw. There's a famous dictum by sociologist W.I. Thomas that says, if people define situations as real, then they are real in their consequences. So it's all what you see, what you understand. The problem in life we sociological and social psychologists will tell you, is that we're not all equally good perceivers. We're not computers. We can be affected in what we see. So even if it's unintentional, some children may see that they don't matter to their families. Some students may see that they don't matter to their teachers. And they're not wrong, because that's what they see. Often the difficult thing is to try to convince someone that he or she matters to you. If they have received socialization that tells them, up to this point, they don't matter in this world, it's going to be very hard to penetrate that wall. I have a phrase that I use for all my students at Brown, in all the classes I teach. What gets in early gets in deep. And it's hard to unlearn what you've already learned back in the day when you couldn't critique what you were learning. The other thing about mattering that's so important is that it is a motivator. Some elements of the self-concept are just categories, like our sex. Not to say that they're not important, but some elements of the self-concept spur us because they trigger basic fundamental needs inside a human being. I said very little of human nature is innate, but I will tell you that these motivators are. And mattering is a motivation. We absolutely need to matter. And I'm going to go so far as to say that it's the most important motivation inside the human being. Self-esteem used to be thought of as the motivating factor, and it's still very powerful, don't get me wrong. But self-esteem isn't where it starts. It starts with mattering. Before anything else, before we can feel good about ourselves, we need to know that we make a difference. And you can understand the connection between the two. If we matter, what can we conclude? We can conclude that we must have something to offer people. And if we have something to offer people, then we can be glad about ourselves. Something that's noticeable within us. Something that gets people to care about what happens to us. Something that other people have need of. All those things tell us that we're an okay person. In contrast, if you feel you don't matter, what's the attribution you're likely to make? Well, it's because I have nothing to offer. I have nothing interesting to capture people's attention. I have nothing worth promoting inside myself. And I have nothing to give people in need. And that means a very low level of self-esteem. So the structure of the self-concept is such that mattering takes priority and affects all other motivations inside us. It is the primal motivation for human beings. So that begs the question, what happens to us if we come to the conclusion that we do not matter? A terrifying awareness. It is so terrifying that we cannot stand it. It is untenable. So we have two options. One option is if it doesn't come, quote, naturally, then I need to make it happen. I need to compel them by doing something that will attract attention, by doing something that will get people to invest in me, by doing something that will show other people how much they really need me. Here's the poster boy for somebody who believed that he did not matter. If you don't recognize him, that is Timothy McVeigh. Timothy McVeigh was an interesting person, sort of. Interesting in the sense that throughout his early life, he knew he didn't matter to anybody. After he was captured and the news media descended upon his former high school and grammar school and talked to the teachers who were there, they said, I don't really remember him. I don't know anything about him. But the one place he did matter was when he joined the Army, because it turned out he was a really good shot. He became a marksman. And that made a huge difference for him. He had a place. People noticed him. People commended him on his abilities. People wanted him around. And then he decided, I'm going to go and go for the real elite forces. So he tried to join the Rangers in the Army. Trouble was, he didn't have what it takes, and he washed out. That was a crushing blow to him. And so, in a moment of desperation, he left the military, the only place that had noticed him. And as he went through life after that, he descended farther and farther into not mattering, until he finally took up with some fringe groups. And he realized in those fringe groups that there he could do something that would get everyone's attention. So one day, with the help of his friends, he loaded up homemade explosives in a van, parked the van in the front of the federal building in Oklahoma City, walked away from it, and triggered the explosion that took down the entire facade of that building. Many people killed, including a number of children who were at the daycare center provided for the federal office workers. Finally, he mattered. He said to his attorney, during the trial, you heard of the shot heard around the world? Well, I fired the shot heard around the world. When he was captured, he wasn't unhappy, because now he was on TV all the time. Newspapers were writing about him all the time. In acting out in this extreme way, he finally got to matter. This is a second and even more dire possibility open to people who don't matter. You come to realize, if I don't matter, who's going to miss me? I'm already socially invisible. Why don't I just complete it by becoming physically invisible? If you really believe you do not matter, then what's the use? You could just check out. And at the very least, who knows what happens after you die, but at the very least, you won't feel the agony of not mattering anymore. We call this mattering in memory. It takes the form of, oh, you don't appreciate me now. But when I'm gone, you're going to be really sorry. You're going to know how valuable I was, and you'll realize what opportunities you've missed. And then you'll appreciate me, but it'll be too late. You may know Sung Bee Cho, student at Virginia Tech.
who was really convinced that he did not matter to anyone at that school, even though he had an English professor who was really trying to help him. He couldn't hear it. He couldn't see it. Back to the perception notion again. And so he decided that if he doesn't matter, he's going to go out, but he's going to go out in a blaze of glory. So he took a number of weapons and walked through the Virginia Tech campus and started shooting, killing a number, wounding many. The day he did that, he sent a manifesto to NBC News. I don't know if it's still online, but I went there to see what that manifesto said, and it was full of mattering. And it was precisely the mattering in memory. None of you appreciated me here at this college. You treated me badly. He even compared himself to Jesus Christ. I'm going to sacrifice myself for the betterment of all. And so he did. He never expected to survive this incident. He just wanted to make sure that people knew who he was when it was all over. So I want to talk to you about a study that I did. A nationally based study of 2,000 plus adolescents on the phone, which we were interested in testing the hypothesis that if you don't matter, you're more likely to do one of these two options, either act out or consider self-destructive behavior, do self-destructive behavior. So I have a 24-item index that measured the perceived mattering. And in this case, I took the unit to which the child needs to matter the most, and that is to one's family. So the items ask how much you believe you matter to your family, not to a particular individual in the family, but the family as a unit. You know, people talk about adolescents needing to become autonomous and separating from their family. They don't need to separate. They do need the autonomy, but they need to know somewhere beneath all that that they still matter to that family, even as they are carving out their own identity. So here's an item, one of the items that did awareness. Whatever else, my family does not ignore me. You had to respond to that on a 7-option Likert scale. If you agreed with that, that tended to say, I know I matter. If you disagreed, that would push you toward the not mattering end of the continuum. Here's an item that measured importance. There is no one in my family who really takes pride in my accomplishments. Well, if you agree with that, that means you didn't believe you mattered. If you disagree, it says yes. At least in this way, I matter to my family. And here's an item from the Reliance Index. People in my family count on me to be there in times of need. Once again, an agreement means mattering. A disagreement means not mattering. So I looked at a series of antisocial and self-destructive behaviors. The antisocial part is the attempt to compel that. The self-destructive is finishing the process of being invisible. You know, you think about an adolescent who doesn't believe that he or she matters to the family. You can imagine, easily imagine, how they might respond. For example, kid might think to himself, okay, Dad, or Mom, you don't pay any attention to me during the week, but when you have to come down to the jail to bail me out on Saturday, you'll pay attention. Now, it's not good attention, but it's some attention. And mattering is so important that negative attention is better than no attention at all. At the very least, you'll know that they are focused on you. You wish you didn't have to do it this way, but rather do that than to confirm your invisibility. These are some of the antisocial behaviors that we look at. Ways adolescents could act out in order to gain attention. Everything from vandalism and theft and dealing drugs, all the way up, and what I'm going to use today, is doing physical violence. The self-destructive behaviors we looked at, binge drinking, potentially lethal. The use of potentially lethal substances like heroin or PCP. And the one I'm going to talk about today, suicide. So I looked for the acting out for violence against this very same family. We asked them this question. Now, the good news on the responses was that most of the kids didn't do any violence to their family. So we had to take the number of times and dichotomize them into two categories. No, I did not. Yes, I did. And that's what made it possible to analyze the responses here. What I'm going to show you here is the results of an analysis, a statistical analysis, and now I'm not going to explain the statistical analysis. What I'm looking at is the probability of committing violence as a function of how much you believe you matter. And we're going to start at the average level of mattering, the mean. The probability that you will do violence against your family is quite low. 0.16, not bad. But look what happens as you begin to feel that you don't matter. The less you believe you matter, the greater the probability that you're going to do violence against that family. It gets up to about 0.3, which is not huge. But if you were in that family, it might be very uncomfortable. The other thing we looked at was attempted suicide. We asked in the last 12 months whether they actually had attempted suicide. We also, by the way, asked if they had thought about doing suicide, if they had planned to do a suicide, but I'm showing you the most extreme. Once again, we dichotomized this because there were very few people who had attempted suicide. So it was a yes-no variable that we were analyzing. And here's the probabilities, again, for different levels of mattering. Can you take it all the way to the start and turn the volume way up? This is Buddy Holly singing about his breakup with an unfaithful lover. I'll find somebody new, and we'll say we're through, and you won't matter anymore. All right, let's try the third one.
Once in my life, I have someone who needs me. Someone I've been dating so long.
Somebody needs me. Mattering is all around you if you look for it. Most of us never think about it
because thank goodness most of us really believe we matter to somebody or some institution. So how do we get somebody to believe that they matter? Well, the first thing is, mattering can't be bestowed. You can't look at somebody, point to them, and say, there, you matter. It doesn't work. Mattering has to be induced. It's better if it starts from birth. But it's not hopeless if it hasn't. Among other things, mattering can be induced if you really listen to the person you're talking to. Have you ever been in a conversation where you think the conversation is interesting to you, but the other person is looking at his or her watch all the time? What does that tell you? How much do you think you matter in that circumstance? Really important to listen to other people when you're interacting with them. Convey an interest in what they're doing. This isn't hard. But the unfortunate thing is we live in a society that does not encourage this. We live in a society that encourages isolation from each other. So what should be a natural occurrence becomes a task. You don't have to like somebody to let them know that they matter to you. It'd be nice if you did. But it isn't absolutely necessary. But I hope you can see from what we have said today how critically important it is for the other to know that he or she matters. Failing to matter is the worst failure a human being could have. And it will either lead to outrageous behavior, or even worse, it will lead to checking out. Thank you for listening to me today.
Because the students will know this guy just didn't throw the papers down the stairs
and use that for the grading system. If they come to see you in office hours, you let them know you're glad they're there, even if they just interrupted you in a very important task. There are all kinds of ways. And basically, what you want to find a way to do is tell the students, you are another human being who can capture my attention, who has something worthwhile to look at, and I need you in particular ways. I need you to play the role of student. If you don't play the role of student, I can't teach you. Did I get at it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going.
Go ahead.
So I'm doing a research on shower abuse and how some people actually end up not repeating what the abuser did, and some people actually imitate the abuser. So I'm thinking, could it be that people, because I'm reading about it, and some people that found someone that mattered, that was caring for them after they went through that, it changed. Because it seems that also that people that do someone that matter still went to the violent side.
There is a phenomenon in abuse, and in fact all child development recognizes it. It's called resilience. A kid who has been through the worst upbringing can still turn out okay. Somebody who is psychologically abused as a child, physically abused, even sexually abused as a child, that kid can still turn out okay if there is one person in that child's life who takes a sincere interest in that child's welfare. Might be a teacher, might be a member of the clergy, might be a friend's mother. But what is that factor but matter? If someone says, I see something in you, and I know you've had a hard time, but you're going to be okay, that's matter. And that can help break the intergenerational cycle of violence. No guarantees. And the person will still have to live with the fact that they didn't matter. But it's a lot easier to live with it if you've got someone else supporting you. Back it out?
Yes.
Okay, there was a question up here? Yes.
Yes, as far as the battery and the retention of drop-off, can you commit any studies? I really think that's one of the things.
I think you're absolutely correct. I think, you know, it's so sad when a student drops out, because you see all the potential. And I'm of two minds on this. On the one hand, you can't make them stay. And you have to allow for the fact that maybe this isn't the time for them to be in college. But on the other hand, you're so afraid that they won't come back. I think mattering makes a huge difference there. If a student knows that a faculty member, a dean, somebody actually cares that they're around and will understand the outside pressures that they have, especially as President Hughes was talking about here at CCRI, where there are so many outside pressures. This is where the faculty, the staff, the administration can play a central role in these students' lives by saying, yeah, I know you got all that, but it makes a difference to me that you're here. I want to see you here. I don't want to force you to be here, but I want to see you here. It's tough, because this world is not meant for people who have great means. There was another hand up over here. Oh, yes.
Okay, and all that we heard here this morning, as you know, as educators, you know, we talk about with the understanding of mattering, but how are we as educators implementing it in our younger children? Because it all starts at home beginning in, you know, early child age and learning. So as educators, how can we implement that? Or are we doing something to do that to drop the rate in our societies and poverty? And it's a huge issue because that's where, you know, most of our children, you know, mostly of poverty, that they don't matter. you know, in regards of, you know, living life at home and you know, in school, you know, how is it something that we can work on, you know, as a society, as here in Rhode Island, are we implementing anything?
Well, we'd all like to save the world, but we know we can't. The only thing we can know is that we can make a difference in somebody else's life, that we can come to matter to somebody else. Any of you all seen The Wire, the HBO series, The Wire? Best series ever on television. You ought to see it. 5 seasons, but it's worth it. Binge watch something. The first season has to do with gangs and drugs. And these two young adolescents are sitting out in the Cabrini Green Project in Chicago. Actually, that's not right. They're in Baltimore. So in the effectively the same project in Baltimore, for those of you who come from Baltimore. And one of them saying to the other, boy, you know, my mom, she's always on me. She's always wanting to know where I am, whom I'm with, what I'm going to be doing. I can't stand it. And the other kid says, you know, you're lucky. My mom doesn't care if I come or go. My mom doesn't want to know who I'm with. My mom just says, as long as you leave me alone, I'll leave you alone. That's not mattering. The only thing we can do is reach out. We can't hogtie people and tell them that they matter. But believe me, people are very sensitive to that reaching out. Not everybody, not all the time. But if it's consistent, it may very well have an effect. What I tell my students who do want to save the world tomorrow, what I tell them is, maybe what you can do is cause a ripple. And that ripple will go out and affect other people. And they, in turn, will cause a ripple. Maybe all you can do is advance the ball closer to the goal line. Maybe you can't get it all in, because one of the truths of sociology is that social change is glacial. It takes forever for things to be different, in a good way, also in a bad way. So maybe all we can do is reach out to those who are in our immediate presence on a daily basis and let them know that in different ways, they, each of them, matter to us. Do all the things that connect us to other people. That's a very unnatural thing to do in our society. It's, as I said, a task, and it should be easy. Any other questions? Yes?
I just want to say, I can relate to that this year. We have,
Uno momento, por favor.
Can you hear me?
I can relate to that this year. We have a student in our program whose boyfriend committed suicide last year, and he was a student here. I got to really kind of work with her and refer her to the Good Samaritans and also counseling here. She's still with us. Yeah, we feel good about it. Our programs on dental health, we're very into our students in their lives. So I feel like I made a difference for her.
Session one, and otherwise all session one starts at 11 o'clock, so you have to